Brownie Girl Scouts, I'm Eleanor Gardner. I'm the Outreach and Engagement Coordinator at the University of Kansas, KU, Natural History Museum in Lawrence. I'm also a lifetime Girl Scout. Today, I'm going to help you complete a couple of the requirements for the Brownie Bugs Try It badge. We're going to learn a little bit about insects and see some in action, and then I'll share how entomologists at the museum collect insects to study them. So first, what is a bug? The term bug most often refers to insects. And insects are small organisms with an exoskeleton, which means that their skeleton is on the outside of their body. Insects have three body parts comprised of the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. Insects have six legs and they have compound eyes. A good number of insects also have wings. And most insects go through metamorphosis, taking them from their initial immature form to their adult form. And we see this when caterpillars in their larval stage then morph while they're inside their cocoons and emerge as adult butterflies. The term bug is also sometimes incorrectly applied to millipedes and centipedes, which together make up the myriapod group, or sometimes applied to arachnids, which is the group that includes spiders, mites, ticks, and scorpions. Myriapods and arachnids are not insects. Insects are the largest group of animals on the planet. Scientists estimate that there are between 5 to 10 million different species of insects on Earth, and insects are found on every continent, including Antarctica. Insects have been evolving on Earth for a long time. There are fossils of insects preserved in rocks that date all the way back to more than 400 million years ago during what is known as the Devonian geologic period. During the Carboniferous period, which is between 360 and 299 million years ago, insects got huge, including gigantic dragonfly-like insects that had wingspans over 2 feet long. Can you tell that I'm a paleontologist by training? I love Earth's history and what fossils tell us about ancient ecosystems. But back to insects. At the KU Natural History Museum in our Bugtown exhibit, we have over 10 different species of live insects and arachnids on display. In this video, we're going to observe three of these insects, the darkling beetle, the blue death feigning beetle, and the Madagascar hissing cockroach. So here we are in a portion of the beetle exhibit within the Bugtown room at the museum. And on top of this little portion of a log here, we have a blue death feigning beetle. These beetles are native to southwestern United States and Mexico, and they live in deserts. And they're very well equipped for this desert survival. They're really hardy and they have amazing recuperating abilities. They also instinctually mimic death when threatened. So that's why they get their name death feigning beetle. Over here, we have a darkling beetle. These guys are scavengers. They are found around the world and their habitat include deserts, semi-desert areas, as well as grasslands. They are scavengers, as I mentioned, and they play an important role as recyclers in our ecosystem by eating decaying animals as well as decaying plants. You may be more familiar with their larvae, which are known as mealworms, and they can live above as well as below ground, and they love especially decaying logs. When threatened, the darkling beetles can warn predators by putting their head down and their back end up, and if that doesn't scare off the predator, then they emit a dark, foul liquid that causes the predator to want to leave immediately. And here we have the Madagascar hissing cockroaches. These cockroaches are native to the island of Madagascar off the coast of Africa, so they are considered an exotic insect, and they're famous for using a hissing sound, which is primarily a defense mechanism, but they also use that to communicate with each other. And they make the hissing sound by forcing air through a pair of modified breathing holes called spiracles on the side of their bodies. And that's that air being forced through is what makes that trademark hissing noise. These cockroaches are one of the largest species and one of the few wingless roaches, which makes it convenient for handling them
at public programs at the museum. Now here you can see that this cockroach is working hard to use its mandibles to nibble away at the pellets that we provide them for food at the Natural History Museum. In the wild, they would use these mandibles to eat fruit that had fallen to the forest floor. An additional interesting thing about Madagascar hissing cockroaches is that females appear to bear living young. Now, technically what happens is that the females have an egg case called an ootheca, which is where the eggs hatch and then develop into nymphs, and those nymphs emerge. And a female hissing cockroach can produce up to 60 nymphs emerging in one nymph release event.
If you like to observe insects up close in your backyard, you'll need a few pieces of equipment. Entomologists frequently use nets like this to capture flying insects like moths and bees. And they grab right about here to keep the insect in the bottom portion of the net. Beetle sheets are used to collect smaller crawling insects that are hard to see. And so what you do is you place this beetle sheet under a bush and then you shake the bush to cause the insects to fall onto your sheet, where you can then collect it using an aspirator. And so aspirators are used to collect typically quite small insects, and they use a tube, a bulb, and a vial in order to do this. And so the bulb creates suction, which forces the insect through the tube and into the vial. Now, if you don't have any of these pieces of scientific equipment, instead you could try making your own net. And there are several different DIY tutorials online for that. You could also try making your own beetle sheet by using just something like a pillowcase underneath a bush. Having a small container with holes in the lid will also be really useful for observing insects. And you can often find bug magnifiers like this one for cheap online. And they work great because they have that magnifier in the top that allows you to see all the different characteristics of the insect up close. If you are interested in photographing insects, smartphone lenses like this MPOW smartphone lens allows you to take macro photos with your cell phone. And so what you do is you just clip it over top of your cell phone lens like so, and it allows you to take those macro photos. So with these items plus handy guides like this, you'll soon be well on your way to becoming a bug expert. Thanks for watching.